Good morning. Welcome to the Universalist Unitarian Church of Riverside. I'm Bonnie McFarland, a member of the Worship Committee, and I will be one of your worship associates today. You will also hear the voices of Grace Price, Dinah Rowe, and Adam Wedeking. We invite you to worship with us with an open mind and an open heart. This service was created by members of UUA, the Unitarian Universalist Association, our national organization. Faith in Unitarian Universalism isn't just an intellectual exercise. It's heart work, work of the heart. This full-length worship experience features a sermon by UUA President the Reverend Dr. Susan Frederick-Gray, as well as vibrant music, storytelling, and other worship elements that will help us to grow in spirit, in courage, and in generosity. Other UUA leaders in the service are Reverend Vale Weller, UUA's Congregational Giving Director, and Reverend Erica Hewitt, UUA's Minister of Worship Arts. Worship leaders in the video include Reverend Chris Long and Reverend Mariela Perez Simons. Reverend Long is a graduate of Star King for the ministry here in Berkeley and is currently an associate minister of Community Church of New York. Reverend Perez Simons is a Cuban-American UU minister. She teaches about oppression, repression, authenticity, belonging, and emotional intelligence. Following today's service, we will have a 15-minute discussion period related to the service, which will be led by Grace and Adam. Although this will be a somewhat longer than usual service, chat time will begin at 11:30. Adam will address the after-service schedule and share other announcements at the end of the service. And now we begin with a prelude, a beautiful hymn by the Women's Eight of All Souls UU, Washington, D.C., a beautiful historic church which I have been privileged to visit many times in years gone by.
Oh. Welcome. I'm Reverend Erica Hewitt, the Minister of Worship Arts at the Unitarian Universalist Association. I live on the ancestral lands of the Abenaki people on the coast of Maine, and my pronouns are she, her, hers.
I'm Reverend Vail Weller, Congregational Giving Director at the UUA. I live on the ancestral land of the Ohlone people in San Mateo, California, and I use she, her pronouns. This worship service is an offering from your UUA, Worship Web, our Stewardship and Development Department, and your UUA President. It's an expression of our covenant to and with each other.
You are part of us and we are part of you. In our joyful process of collaboration with the stellar religious professionals you're about to meet, we centered our care for you, the congregations of the Unitarian Universalist Association.
Even in these times when we are with one another virtually, let us remember that we belong to one another.
We are loved into being.
These are times of isolation and loneliness. Our hearts long for connection and for one another.
Illness has visited our lives. Struggle and pain are in our communities. Our children's lives have been disrupted. There has been such great loss.
And yet, we are surrounded by beauty, by grace, and by music that blesses us.
All the while, we are surrounded by love. We are loved into courage.
We are loved into community. We are loved into generosity. We are loved into being. We are loved into being.
Come, let us open our hearts and grow the size of our souls. Come, let us worship together.
I'm joining you here from First Parish in Cambridge, and I want to thank the First Parish community and Reverend Adam Lawrence Dyer for offering their space to us. First Parish sits on the occupied land of the Massachusetts people. A community of the Massachusetts people still live in Massachusetts in the community of Canton. I have a story for you today. And there's two things that are important about this story. Number one, it's a true story. And number two, it's an anonymous story. So I read this story many years ago in Yes magazine, and the author of the story was listed only as Jane B. I love this story because it speaks to the fact that even in incredibly difficult circumstances, that the presence of love, that acts of generosity and hospitality really are life-saving. Here's Jane's story. Jane and her brother grew up in the 1940s in Hollywood, California, a town known for show business. Now, Jane says that she and her brother were adopted by their parents, not because their parents loved children, but because their parents thought it completed the image of the perfect Hollywood family, a beautiful home in Beverly Hills, a fleet of servants, two adorable children, and a little spaniel dog. Jane and her brother hardly ever saw their parents. They were largely raised by the housekeepers and nannies. It was only on Sunday when the whole family went to the country club. There, Jane and her brother were expected to be perfectly well behaved, not to run around or get dirty, to know which piece of silverware to use at every course, to be seen but not heard. They were taught to speak only when spoken to. Looking back, Jane said of herself, "I wasn't a real girl. I was a cardboard cutout of a girl." Jane's best memories from her childhood were when she was with her grandmother. And one day, her grandmother took her to a rummage sale in a church basement. Now, this was Hollywood, California. So this rummage sale was filled with costumes and fancy clothes that were from the movies or from movie stars. Jane's grandmother gave her $2, which was a lot of money at that time, and said, buy whatever you want. Well, Jane went home with two armfuls of things. And as soon as she got home, she ran straight up to her room with all of that loot. And she started trying things on. Finally, she settled on a little pink nightdress, a big broad hat, white satin gloves, and every piece of costume jewelry that she bought. She looked at herself in the mirror, and Jane was awestruck. She looked like a different person. She decided to give herself a new name, Madame Modifus. Now, whereas Jane was quiet, Madame Modifus was bold. And whereas Jane was shy, Madame Modifus was flamboyant. And whereas Jane always did exactly as she was told, well, Madame Modifus, she had a mind of her own. Jane, all dressed up, ran down the stairs across the yard to the house next door and knocked on the door. When the mother next door and her little son opened the door, their jaws fell open. Jane said, my name is Madame Modifus. May I come in for tea? Well, the mother and her son, they welcomed Jane into their home. They played for hours, and then Jane went back to her house. Now, any time that Jane had a little bit of time to herself, she would get all dressed up and she would run to the neighbor's house, and they just came to call her Madame Modifus. Jane ends her story by sharing how she now is a grandmother, and that one of her favorite things to do is to visit her own grandchildren, and that whenever she goes to see them, they wait for her outside on the yard, and when she pulls into the driveway, they jump up and down and scream her name, Madi, 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 the only name they've ever known her by.
Thank you. can't do nothing.
Sharing joys and concerns is an important part of belonging to this beloved community. On the Sunday of each month, we share the joys and concerns that we have received from you throughout the month. Please be sure to email or text your joys and concerns throughout the month to Dinah Rowe, our Caring Network Coordinator. You can call or text her at 909-645-2885. On the first Sunday of each month, we place a stone in our water chalice to represent the joys and concerns we have shared with our church community and in recognition of those we hold close and have not shared. It was previously shared that Bill Rowe was diagnosed with multiple myeloma. We have good news in the joys section. Alec Peck, our music coordinator, wrote, "I lost my keyring with all but my car keys. All the keys themselves are replaceable, but my hardcore Iron Man, by the way, keychain is no longer being made." We place a symbolic stone in our water chalice for the concerns shared and in recognition of all those held close and not shared. Joys. Linda Greer wrote, "I would like to share joy that I am finally healing after enduring many months of terrible pain. The operation went well and was very successful. Also, I would like to express my gratitude to all the friends in church and in the community that have supported and encouraged me and my family through this long, painful journey. Thank you." Kate Lewicki wrote, "Joy that I received the second dose of the Moderna vaccine with minimal side effects and soon will be able to do my own shopping and will be ready and able to run sound again when we reopen." Alec Peck wrote, "I survived my winter quarter midterms. There is one class I've been very stressed about, but it turns out that my score for that midterm was the highest in the class. Way to go, Alec." Dinah wrote, our granddaughter Ashley says we have a superhero. Bill had his third chemotherapy plus second COVID-19 vaccine and is feeling fine. No side effects." We place a symbolic stone in our water chalice for the joys we have shared and all those we have not.
Dear ones, we will now enter a time of libations, lamentation, and prayer. The pouring of libations is a centuries-old ritual performed by many cultures. At the core of this sacred ritual is the calling forth of personal and collective ancestors across the millennium and across all space. Libations are poured to honor life, all life. Before we begin, it is just and holy that we honor the original lands of the indigenous community or communities where we live. As I am here at Community Church of New York in New York City, specifically Midtown Manhattan, I must honor that these lands are of the Lenape peoples. The Lenape offspring of the Algonquin civilization and includes present-day New Jersey, New York, and Delaware. If you know them, please call to mind the indigenous peoples where you reside, honoring that these lands are not ours, and we must always honor this truth. I will now call upon the ancestors from all directions as I remain before you, even virtually. I invite you to respond Ashe as each direction is honored. The pouring of libations. To the east, lands of the rising sun, elements of air with the color yellow, ancestors of the east, be with us now. Ashe. To the south, welcoming the ancestors of African ancestry, the element is fire and the color is red, be with us now. Ashe. To the west, lands of the setting sun, the element of water with the color of blue, the emotional realm, ancestors of the west, be with us now. Ashe. To the north, the elements of earth with the color of green, the direction of sustenance and grounding, ancestors of the north, be with us now. Ashe. Lastly, I pour libations to the heavens, the plants, the seas, the animals, and all winged creatures. Be with us now. Ashe. Our time of lament. Friends, both near and far, we have been and are in some of the most difficult times the world has experienced in over 100 years. COVID-19 continues to unleash havoc on this country and the world, with over 500,000 people dying here in the United States, the most the world over, even as over a million vaccines are being given daily. The level of grief so many are experiencing, with isolation, feeling like incarceration, full-time parenting, providing online full-time educational learning for children is much too much. That is, if you can afford to be at home at all. Some of our workloads have produced a level of fatigue, particularly for some mothers and other caregivers, creating levels of despair, which is leading to depression. We indeed must lament. We must grieve how difficult this is and continues to be for so many. At once, it's also true that we recently heard the life expectancy for everyone has decreased during the pandemic. For African Americans, social scientists have stated the life expectancy during the pandemic is decreased by 3 years. 2 years for our Latinx communities and 1 year for those who are white. We also know as a country, the vaccines are being distributed in inequitable ways, and the world over, 75% of the vaccines are going to more wealthy countries, not where they are needed most. We must lament. Yes, give yourself time to lament, to grieve, to shout, scream, cry, and sometimes it feels laughable how it's going on. And we can continue to find beauty. Let us continue to reach out to others in even more innovative ways. Lean on and nurture your Unitarian Universalist faith and share what you are feeling. Let us also create. Let's create music, art, joy, and safe human touch where possible. Amen. I couldn't hear y'all. Amen. I would now like to invite us into a moment of prayer as we prepare our hearts and minds for today's Loved Into Being service. Please take a few moments to locate your breath in your body. Take this moment to breathe deeply. Just notice where your breath is in your body without judgment. A moment of prayer. Spirit of life, love, nameless one, God. We gather in times of great peril for so many. Our social and political systems are in great upheaval, even as we are rising up to end all systemic oppressions. Yet, the COVID-19 virus continues to mutate, even as the vaccines are being given. 10 million people have lost their jobs, with many of them, mostly Black and Brown people, will never return to those very jobs. It's also true that millions in Texas and other parts of the globe are experiencing impacts of climate change, which will forever change their lives. Great Spirit, be with us now and them always. As we prepare our hearts and minds for the word today, please give us the courage to know that Unitarian Universalism can and does transform lives, and we have sacred, holy work to do to decenter whiteness within ourselves, each congregation, and our communities. Our communities and the world need our highest aspirations and ideals as a living faith tradition to rise up in all of us as we continue to love ourselves and each other into holy being. This is ongoing, demanding, sacred, yes, sacred work. And I believe we collectively can do it. Do you? Amen. Ashe. Blessed be. Shalom, salam, and may it be so. Thank you.
Comfort me,
I would like to begin by acknowledging that I live in the traditional land of the people of the Three Fires. I am deeply honored and grateful to the land itself and to the people who have taken care of it for generations. And today I bring to you a quote from the process theologian Bernard Lumer, who says, by size, I mean the stature of a person's soul. I mean the range and depth of your love, your capacity for relationships. I mean the volume of life you can take into your own being and still maintain your integrity and individuality. The intensity and variety of outlook you can entertain in the unity of your being without feeling defensive or insecure. I mean the strength of your spirit to encourage others to become freer in the development of their diversity and their uniqueness. I mean the power to sustain more complex and enriching tensions. I mean the magnanimity of concern to provide conditions that enable others to increase in stature. End of quote. Of the hundreds of books I had to read for seminary, of the thousands of passages that I read and highlighted and marked, this one has stayed with me the most. From the moment I read that quote, I was like, that is it. Because since I came from Cuba in 1995, I have been in many liberal religious circles, and we had been having in those circles this amazing conversation about what was out there, amazing conversations about the meaning of life, but no one was talking about what goes on in here, at the core of our being. No one was talking about our humanity and the struggles that come with being human, as well as the delights. This quote was talking about these tensions inside of us, the expansion, the volume, the range, the depth, the complexities of our humanity. Shall I read that quote again? Let's read it again. Here it is. By size, I mean the stature of a person's soul, the range and depth of your love, your capacity for relationships. I mean the volume of life you can take into your own being and still maintain your integrity and individuality. The intensity and variety of outlook you can entertain in the unity of your own being without feeling defensive or insecure. I mean the strength of your spirit to encourage others to become freer in the development of their diversity and their uniqueness. I mean the power to sustain more complex and enriching tensions. I mean the magnanimity of concern to provide conditions that enable others to increase in stature. Here's another reason why I love that quote so much, why it resonated with me so much. It's particularly this line, I mean the strength of your spirit to encourage others to become freer in the development of their diversity and uniqueness. I was like, what if that is the future of liberal religion? What if this is where we have failed by not encouraging others to become freer in the development of their own diversity and their uniqueness? The story of Madame Modifus is a story that is painfully familiar to me. Someone who came from another country, from another culture, and having to tone it down in order to fit in. Because my whole self was not, is not welcomed in some places. And what I know about the human soul is that it goes into hiding. It goes into hiding when we can be our full selves, our whole self. And that breaks my heart every single day, seeing what oppression and repression does to the human soul, to our core, to what is most authentic, most unique, most precious about us. What having to repress our life force does to our psyches. I know. And so this quote is asking us to grow the size of our soul, to expand, to open up and let in more perspectives and more languages and more cultures and more colors, more diverse wisdom, and to wrestle with how that contradicts our own worldview. It is asking us not just to allow others their uniqueness, but to invest in the growth of others. That's my second favorite line. I mean the magnanimity of concern to provide conditions that enable others to increase in stature. And that is love, beloveds. That is love. That is love. That investment in creating the right conditions for all of us to grow and flourish. And you know what Zora Neale Hurston said about that, right? She said, love make your soul crawl out from its hiding place. Love make your soul crawl out from its hiding place. May we create more loving conditions. May we invest in love. May it be so. May it be so. Amen. Anashe.
I realize. love, love. I need love. Love is what I need to help me know my name. And if you just love me, love will help me know my name.
Yes, love is what I need to know my name. These words from the artist Seal capture the meaning of our story today. The story of Jane and her discovery of her full self and her real name, Maudie. Jane's story captured my attention the first time I read it. Her words, "I wasn't a real girl. I was a cardboard cutout of a girl." They stayed with me. It's clear the trauma and the pain of her home life. And this isn't unique or even uncommon for children, for any of us. So many of us know these experiences in our home lives, in our work lives, or in the stifling cultural conditions of oppression that seek to make us small, quiet, invisible. Conditions that seek to rob us of our fullness. But then something happens for Jane. Through the love of her grandmother, the generous embrace of the neighbors, and a little bit of imagination, Jane's full self, Maudie, finds expression. The freedom she experiences is in moments. Those moments when she's able to steal away from her house and go to her neighbors. But it is enough. These small moments of joy and love in the midst of the neglect and the suffering, they are life-saving. Zora Neale Hurston writes, "Love makes your soul crawl out from its hiding place." And that is exactly what Maudie's soul does. She is loved into the fullness of her being. I hear echoes of my own story in this story. And maybe you do too. For me, in a time of tremendous difficulty in my life, my UU church was the neighbor's house, full of warmth and welcome, music and imagination. And the grandmother? That was my Sunday school teachers, whose love and care, coupled with joy and attention, it made a difference in my life when I most needed it. That congregation, that community, those teachers, they helped me find my voice, my spirit, my soul. They loved me into being. I imagine that you too have stories like this. How Unitarian Universalism, its theology, its people, its ministry changed you, saved your life, helped your soul crawl out of its hiding space. How it helped grow the size of your soul. As process theologian Bernard Loomer so powerfully describes, by size, I mean the stature of a person's soul, the range and depth of your love, your capacity for relationships. I mean the volume of life you can take into your being and still maintain your integrity and individuality. There's so much expansiveness and generosity in Loomer's definition of the size of your soul. And he goes on. He says, "I mean the strength of your spirit to encourage others to become freer in the development in their diversity and uniqueness. I mean the magnanimity of concern to provide conditions that enable others to increase in stature." You see, Loomer is not just talking about individual growth and liberation. And this matters to us as Unitarian Universalists because our faith has never been solely about individual spiritual growth. As Unitarian Universalists, we understand salvation not as individual, but collective. We recognize the fundamental interconnectedness, interdependence of all life and of humanity. Foundational to the core theological idea of interdependence is that mutuality and responsibility are inherent to who we are as human beings. We are not islands. And our tradition calls us not to individual freedom or transformation alone, but to the liberation and thriving of all people. One of the most important and successful campaigns within Unitarian Universalism over this past year was UU the Vote, a national effort for Unitarian Universalists to partner with local grassroots organizing and voting rights groups on an unprecedented voter engagement, voter registration, and voter turnout effort. It was the first ever effort like this on our part as a larger association, and it was awesome. But here's something you may not know about UU the Vote. When I first shared the idea for UU the Vote at the 2019 General Assembly, I didn't know if it would take hold. I was simply throwing out a seed of a dream, imagining there before thousands of you, congregational delegates at GA, I asked, what if we as UUs helped engage and mobilize 1 million people to vote in the 2020 election? When I said that, it was scary. It seemed impossible. And in fact, the next time I talked about UU the Vote at a local congregation, I reduced the number to 500,000. But before we'd even started to create the team and the infrastructure, when we were still just talking about this idea, congregational leaders, ministers, religious educators, and members were clamoring to volunteer. Financial gifts began coming in, some unsolicited. Folks were ready to say yes, ready to give generously of their time and resources because they knew that our values of justice and compassion, that our system of democracy and the literal lives and well-being of our neighbors, of our loved ones, of each other, were on the line and on the ballot. Thousands of people volunteered. Thousands of donors came forward from our congregations, many of you. And together we invested tens of thousands, if not hundreds of thousands of hours and well over $1 million to vote love in the 2020 election. And in the end, we reached well over 3 million potential voters, far exceeding our wildest dreams. In what was the largest, most transparent and accessible election in our history, we UUs played a significant role. And we were likely the largest, most organized, faith-based pro-democracy effort during the election. Wow. Imagination, generosity, commitment, collective action, these fueled UU the Vote. But there was also some magic to it, because it recognized our strengths and it invited us more fully into who we are. For we are the people who show up. We are the people who work together in community. We are people who believe in democracy, who understand our faith as active, who are concerned about the conditions of justice here and now, and who, when it comes right down to it, are a hopeful people. We are a hopeful people about what is possible and about our agency and capacity to meet the challenges of our time. Some of the magic of UU the Vote was that together we were loving each other into the fullness of who we are as Unitarian Universalists. But this isn't the end of the story. It is a reminder. It is a glimpse of what is possible when we say yes. When we say yes so generously and powerfully to what we believe in, to what we care about, to our ministries, our values, and when we choose solidarity, interdependence with wider networks of people working for justice, compassion, and liberation. From the beginning of my time as UUA president, I have said, this is no time for a casual faith. No time for a casual commitment to what you love most. And this is no time to go it alone. UU the Vote is just one example of what it looks like to take our faith, our values, and our commitment to interdependence seriously. It is life-saving, life-changing ministry. Individually in our own lives, and revolutionary when we bring that powerful yes out into the world. And this yes is what is needed so deeply in our communities and our world right now. To love our society, to love our world into a new place of being. In her important book, Cast, Isabel Wilkerson explores the conditions of racism, white supremacy, and racial hierarchy as an American caste system. And in her book, she quotes Gary Michael Tartikoff, an American scholar of castes, who says of the United States, "This is a civilization searching for its humanity. It dehumanized others in order to build its civilization, and now it needs to find its own." There's power in those words and that history. So how do we find our humanity as a society, as a country, as a civilization? The Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King said the key was love. By love, King did not mean a sentimental or romantic kind of love, but rather an overflowing, audacious, and unconditional love that sought the fullest unfolding of every person. King said, "This love might well be the salvation of our civilization." The only way that we overcome the forces of racism, domination, discrimination, dehumanization, the forces that are at the foundation of the United States, those forces that have the effect of dehumanizing our society, the only way we overcome those forces is to turn to the deepest source of our humanity. And as Unitarian Universalists, we know that that foundation, that source of our humanity, is our compassion and our interdependence, our mutuality and relationship and responsibility to each other. In other words, I would take Bernard Loomer's words and King's words and say, we need to grow the size of our love. And by size, as Loomer says, I mean the range and depth of your love, your capacity for relationships. I mean the volume of life you can take into your being. I mean the strength of your spirit to encourage others to become freer, to provide conditions that enable others to increase their stature, the size of their love and their soul. And this is where the real spiritual depth and calling of our faith lives. Not just as an intellectual exercise, but as embodiment. embodying and growing our capacity for this powerful form of love that encourages all of us to live into the fullness of our being and that is committed to the conditions that make this fullness possible for everyone. Compassion, interdependence. Looking back, the love of her grandmother, that trip to the church rummage sale, and the generous, inclusive embrace of her neighbors made a powerful difference to young Jane, to Maudie. Looking back, the warmth and magic of my UU church and the love and care of my Sunday school and youth leaders shaped my life and my calling in ways that I will always be grateful for and will never be able to repay. Looking back, UU The Vote became this incredible source of community, joy, and positive action in the midst of what was one of the most traumatic times in our lives. It drew us together in unprecedented ways and was a lifeline. And this is not the end of the story. It's just a glimpse, just a few stories to capture some of what is possible in all of our congregations when we say yes. When we say yes boldly, audaciously, powerfully to our values, to our spirits and our love, and to one another. These stories and more are happening all across our congregations. None of us will ever know all the difference that our generosity to our congregations has made to the lives of our children, our families, our elders, to the lives and conditions of our larger communities. We'll never know all the ways that we have helped make a difference. When we give boldly, generously, audaciously of our financial resources as we are able, we make our values and our ministry manifest in the world. When we give generously of our hearts and our care and our love to our children and families, elders and adults, young adults and youth, we change lives. We save lives. And when we dream big, as leaders and staff, about the impact we are called to make in the wider world, lives are changed. The material conditions of our communities can change. We are changed. We make it possible, loved into fullness, loved into being. May we keep saying yes, boldly, courageously, and lovingly to our values and our faith. May it be so.
There are sacred moments, sparkling moments, when we answer the call to live out our values and in so doing, bless the world beyond our imaginings. These powerful, sparkling moments are times when we are truly alive, when we feel and know and demonstrate our values because of the principles that have claimed us, because of this faith that we share, because we have been loved into being. It is time for the offering. This is a chance to give of your tangible energy to benefit the congregation which has nurtured and grown you, so that in turn it can be a powerful presence for future generations. This is an opportunity to make manifest generosity. This is an invitation to align resources and highest values. Susan Frederick-Gray said, "The most important thing you can do for Unitarian Universalism is to generously support your congregation. It's transforming lives." Let us give now because our congregation is transforming lives and communities for the better. Let us give because we have been loved into being and because we want this same gift to be available to others. Let us give because we want generosity to be our response to the world. The offering will both be given and received with abundant gratitude.
Morning. This portion of our service is about funding all that we do to care for our congregation and our beloved historic church. When we are in person at church, this is when the ushers pass the collection plate. At this time, there are several ways you can contribute. You may mail your donations and pledge to the church office or scan the QR code with your phone. This QR code is also on our website and the newsletter. The church address is shown here. We are looking forward to reopening in the very near future so we can all be together again in person and continue with our activities. Please do your part by contributing what you can. Also, a reminder that our annual pledge drive begins this time of the year in preparation for the budget for the fiscal year 2021-2022. We have Stater Brothers cards for your grocery shopping that earns our church a percentage. Please contact me or the church office to purchase Stater Brothers cards. Please donate by whatever method works best for you. Thank you for your generosity, and to those who give of their time and their talent, thank you for your generous care and attention.
You're broken down and tired of living life on a merry-go-round, and you can find the fighter, but I see it in you. Walk it out. Ooh, mountains. Gonna walk it out. Ooh, mountains.
And I'll rise up. I'll rise like the day.
I'll rise.
Thank you.
Dear friends across time and space, as worship comes to a close, may we remember the strength and the beauty that can be found in our faith.
May we feel the power generated by the giving and receiving of gratitude and generosity in our lives.
May we feel ourselves held in the embrace of the covenant that we share and in the tender care of the larger community that has loved us into being.
Through it all, we are held by a love that will never let us go.
May we grow. May we expand. May we flourish. May it be so.
Dear ones, know that we have been held in love, even as we struggle with the holy work that is ours to do.
May we carry a song of love on our hearts as we embark on the work that lies ahead.
May we go out into our lives and into our days with peace, and may we give back love.
It's not the waking or the rising. It's the grounding of a foot I'm compromising. It's not for going of the light. It's not the opening of the eyes. It's not the waking, it's the rising. It's not the shade we should be casting. It's the light and it's the obstacle that cast it. It's the heart that drives the light. It's the fire it ignites. It's not the waking, it's the rising.
It's not the song, but it's the singing. It's the heaven of the human spirit breathing. It is the bringing of the light. It is the bearing of the rhyme. It's not the waking, it's the rising.
And I could cry power,
power,
power, power, Lord. Need a cry power, really cry power, baby's cry power.
And I could cry. I'm
right. So that was the service. Thank you for joining us. We got a couple announcements before we go. And we're gonna have a little time for discussion as well. Chat time is at 11:30, which is in a little bit. So go ahead and you can go to uuchurchriverside.org if you'd like to go to chat time. And there's a link there on the webpage, or if you got an email this morning, there's a link there. Or you can stick around here for our conversation about the service. And then later on this afternoon, there is a Social and Environmental Justice Committee meeting at 1 o'clock. Again, you can go to the church website, click on Justice, Social and Environmental Justice, and join there. Or again, if you got an email this morning, it's got a link there. We've got a number of things to talk about, including a really important thing is this. Riverside Board of Supervisors is going to be discussing, I've talked about before, a resolution to support ACA 3 on Tuesday. We're inviting folks to speak. If you want to speak, you've got to get a request to speak in before 9 a.m. Monday morning, so today. So if you go on the church website, click on Justice and then Social and Environmental Justice, underneath Take Action, you'll find this picture. And there's a little information, a link to click on to leave a comment. And it'll tell you the item number because you need to know the item number. And then there's another link there where you can get some talking points for when you actually speak. The monthly UUCR newsletter comes out the first of every month by email and by request by postal mail. If you have something you'd like covered that you would like to write, let Dinah know at ramblinrose22@yahoo.com, or you can call our texter 909-645-2885. If you haven't received the newsletter and you'd like to be added to the mailing list, let Dinah or the church office know. I know it just came out a few days ago, and it was really good. Had little bits from different members, maybe that we haven't heard from in some time, about how they're doing. It was really nice. Riverside County and all of Southern California region, the ICU availability continues to be at 0.0%, but arrangements are made so no one is left waiting. You can get your information there. I'm not going to read all the information. You can get your information at the website for your county, rivcoph.org/coronavirus for Riverside County, or sbcovid19.com for San Bernardino County, and then covid19.ca.gov for the state of California, and vaccineca.com to get your vaccines. Here is the contact information that has been mentioned earlier in the service. And then I think I'm gonna let everybody unmute themselves. All right, thank you.
Hi, everybody.
Hi, Grace.
Adam, so you're going to help me out with this discussion that we're going to talk about the service?
Sure, I can.
Okay. You have any questions you want to ask first?
No.
Okay. All right. So the theme of this service, I believe, was loved into being. What did you all think about it?
So if I didn't know what the theme was, I would have guessed that it was more about acceptance of one another and individuality. Really, I felt like the third principle was a really prominent message with this one, the ability to accept one another and really encourage each other's spiritual growth and what it means to do that.
Right. She also mentioned, the speaker also mentioned that we should be invested in encouraging each other to increase our stature and our fullness in who we are. Does anyone have any ideas on how we could do that?
Repeat the question, say it again.
How we could encourage each other to grow into our potential stature and fullness of who we individually are. That's kind of abstract, but
define full stature and the other word.
Anybody? Full stature?
Well, I like what they, you know, talked about in the sermon and in the reading that the woman read. I can't remember the theologian's name, about your size being like how much love you can bring in, you know? I really dug that. In Buddhism, the Buddha talks about the four immeasurables, which are like metta, which can be love, depending on how you define love, I guess, but it's the desire for others to be happy. And that should be immeasurable, right? That should be, that's what I like about UUism is universalism, is that it's universal, right? That metta should be universal. But how big can you make that sort of being the practice? And I really like that as how we grow, right? How big can I? And then there's always the struggles, because there's always people that are really difficult, right? To make your heart big enough to bring into, you know, and so you kind of make that your challenge of how can I expand my heart to be big enough to include this person. It's difficult, but and situations and everything, you know, that's what I get out of like your stature, is like how big can your heart be, I think.
Yeah, no, I would add, I think that I think the simplest answer would be to be of service to others. I mean, I don't know. Stature. It's an interesting word, stature. Yeah, probably just be of service to others. And I don't know about the love part, but I think that being of service to others typically would, like, maybe be mindful, like, what is one thing I can do, like, every day to help somebody else, right? And try to be, like, that's a good example. I don't know about saying giving, I don't know, it's whatever the word, I can't remember the word right now, but just be like, just be mindful, like, well, what is one thing I can do to another person this day? Like when I go to this service in person, I was always donating like $1 to $3 for whatever it is, even if I didn't necessarily agree with it, because that helps me practice the act of giving. So maybe just like doing one thing every day that can either be a service to others or some type of financial contribution.
Yeah, thank you, Drew. I agree. And when I think about stature, I think about the book One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest, which is about a Native American. Well, it's told from the perspective from a Native American man who's in a mental institution. And he feels that he's lost his size. He's physically a big person. But he talks about how he no longer has his size because he feels small, because he's lost his stature, is the description that we get throughout the book. And so I think what it means is to, it's more about an internal feeling of a feeling of wholeness, and a feeling like you are everything that you are supposed to be.
I think it's, for me also, I think it's a sense of worthiness. I think that when you feel your worth, your value, that you feel you have, your stature increases.
I was also thinking about how when we are children, before we know about all these boundaries and things, we are just so 100% who we are. And we don't care, and we say what we want. And I think, you know, including the boundaries now as we're adults, and so we still need to have some of that joy and some of that confidence about who we really are that we have as children. I'm sure, Hannah, you could probably relate to that with your kids, right? Well, when they're like toddlers, they're just themselves, period.
Absolutely, yeah. And even into like elementary school, like I think probably up until about fourth grade, those, like, a lot of those kids just have that joie de vivre just innately, like that just drives them and powers them through. And like, they're not ashamed of who they are, and they don't have any of like the grown-up hang-ups for the most part, thank you, that we all have. But it's definitely like, it's definitely like really rejuvenating to like see that, and just see that like when there's one person like that around, it just kind of makes everybody else have that same like presence and like joyfulness just within their day to day, even if it's just for that small time that you're all together. So I think that like trying to take that energy and like lean into that feeling is definitely a way to like encourage others.
Yeah, and I think that another one is that you can be an example for others, right? So if you can't contribute in time, talent, and you can contribute by setting an example, right? Like one of the best things, you can take Jesus, for example, right? Like, well, I'm not Christian, but he tried to set an example for people of how you ought to conduct yourself, and that's helping people, right? If you set a bad example for people, what are they going to do? They're going to copy your bad example. So make sure to try to set a good example, and that'll help. So
this, what that brought to my mind with this was in our faith, one of the important things to me is, I think it's our fourth principle that talks about supporting each other on our individual paths, and that we have a duty, an obligation, as you use, to pursue a responsible search for truth and meaning, whatever that means to us. And we have an obligation to support each other on that path, which I find we sometimes have difficulty with, but that's part of being human and what we need to work on. Is when the other person doesn't agree with us, particularly if they're a Christian, I find that we tend to have trouble with them, and they sometimes leave, which I've been there, done that, so I understand. I think it's important in faith that we have the encouragement to do that searching and not being told what we're supposed to believe, but the opportunity and the encouragement to search and to grow.
So how did you all feel about the statement that that some people have been dehumanized, or some people have dehumanized others in order to build up their own, she said civilization, but in order to build up their own interests, maybe. Are there any thoughts on that?
I think it's a true statement. I mean, throughout history, of course, and even in small ways through things like today, like there's definitely, you can trace like the larger dehumanizing of cultures down to like the small things that we culturally do today very distinctly. And other people, of course, have on that, who have more experience, but I think that's definitely like there's truth to it. Drew?
Yeah, no, I think that's basically true, right? Everyone, okay, if she's making the claim that there was a group of white settlers that went to Jamestown, yeah, okay, yes. But I think that in general, people do that in general. No, I mean, they don't do it always on purpose, but some people put other people down to feel better, right? And why do we do that? Because we feel insecure about ourselves. We just want to, you know, feel good about ourselves. And sometimes we have to treat other people badly. And you might argue, well, okay, slavery was an example of white people trying to feel superior to black people, because in some sense they felt inferior. Well, you have to do that, right? You, in order to subjugate another human being, you have to, in some sense, dehumanize them to make yourself feel bigger. So I think that's going on a lot nowadays, because everyone's trying to feel bigger, and that's not always good.
Inka? I think you need to unmute.
There we go. So Hannah talked about it in terms of systems. Drew talked about it in terms of groups of people. I was thinking, you know, I had to keep everything, all the lessons that I'm trying to learn, I have to bring back to my own, to me. And I have to say, you know, as much as I would love to say that I don't ever do that, I have, you know, and I, there are times in which, well, just in my childhood, I'm the youngest of six kids. And there were times in which each one of us at separate times threw the others under the bus so that we wouldn't get in trouble with our parents, or so that we would, our parents would say, you know, positive glowing things about us, single us out and make us feel special from this group. And so we all have that. We all have that where we want to be the one, you know, that's in the spotlight, or we want to be the one that is thought of as the best or the strongest or the whatever it is. And I think I know for myself that there are times in which I have to watch and be careful, because there is that tendency to ever so subtly or not so subtly to put myself up by having to push somebody else aside. And it's, you know, it's not how I want to be. It's not how I strive to be, but I have to be honest that does happen. That does happen to me even in the midst. And I think that's one of the reasons why we need a spiritual program. Why we, you know, keep coming to church, why we read the spiritual literature that we read, why we do the, you know, whatever our spiritual practices are, to help us resist against those tendencies and to learn other ways.
So another word that has come into our vocabulary is microaggressions. I think overt racism in this country is now sort of looked down on or is not politically correct or whatever. And so we sometimes encounter things that are said very subtly, but still signify certain things. Any thoughts on that?
Yeah, I completely agree. I think there's a definite attitude that even people who think subtly racist or sexist or biased things recognize that saying those things overtly is not socially acceptable, even if in their opinion they are completely true. And so they feel comfortable expressing those things that they assume to be true just more subtly, as long as they think they just have to do it in a way that's socially appropriate, but it's okay because they don't have to question the validity of those assumptions.
Right. But it's kind of a sophisticated system of speaking, but I think that usually when people are targets of that type of microaggression, they feel it. They feel it. Mm-hmm. You know, we have words like dog whistles right now where, you know, it's recognized even though it's not overtly acknowledged. So I think we have to watch for those types of things as well.
To me, I see that often in humor, you know, jokes before I would laugh and think was really funny. Now I sort of cringe, and I'm actually having a difficult time just enjoying comedians or enjoying comedy or whatever, because it seems like so much of it is, you know, somehow disparaging or putting someone else down. And I no longer see that as funny. And so there's a part of me that kind of laments the fact that I don't have, you know, that what I used to have in terms of a greater range of enjoying humor, because I see it differently now.
Hi, everybody. I haven't been here before, and I'm really glad that I came. And
As usual, the Unitarians are a lot of intelligent people with a lot of good stuff to say, so thanks for that. I was just going to say that thinking about the truth and filtering and all that, I came from a family where I was told that people wanted to know the truth, and the truth was what would help everybody. But after years of trying that out, I realized that there is an ultimate truth, and then there's a Dharma truth. And the Dharma truth is much softer and kinder. And it, for me, it takes a little bit of filtering to just not say what comes right to the top of my head, which is the truth, and then just say, well, how's that going to impact whoever hears it? So, thanks.
Was there anything in the service today that anybody else, it struck anyone else or resonated or something they'd like to highlight?
I wanted to ask Bonnie, first of all, I thought this was fantastic. I really, really enjoyed it. I felt it gave me a fuller, richer church experience that I've really been missing, you know, with all of the online things. I do appreciate everything we've gotten so far, so I don't want it to be taken that way. But my question is, was this just something that was put out there because of stewardship, you know, that it was a one-time, one-off kind of a thing to encourage stewardship? Or is this something that they have out, are there a lot of these prepackaged kinds of things that they have out there from the UUA?
Well, we had one last week and then this week. And so this is, the last one was put out for last month. And then this one was available for this month. But these are the first two that I'm aware of. I think maybe it is and there may be others that I haven't researched, but this seems to be a fairly recent response to the fact that everybody is still shut down. and so I'm very appreciative, and I'm going to be in further contact with, this is through Worship Web, and with them to see what else might be coming up. This particular one, like, it wasn't finished. I didn't have access to it to even review it and know all of the contents until late Friday. So they're still, they're really putting this stuff together and doing a beautiful job of it.
They are very, very nice. Well, maybe we'll get at least once a month.
It would be wonderful. Yeah.
I love the music. Yeah. I thought the music was just really inspiring today.
Yeah, yeah.
Yes, I love the Washington, D.C. Nick and I, what was it, a year and a half ago, 2019, when we did our East Coast vacation thing, and we went to all the UU churches all along the East Coast, and we did a service there in Washington, D.C. Beautiful, beautiful. You know, and they just got a new music director and a new children's
But these people might not know it.
I wanted to let Judy know that we are going to be adjourning and going to our chat time, which is where we're not so focused specifically on service, but we're welcome to talk about that, but just to go on and generally talk. And you're very welcome to join us. I'm so glad that you have joined us this time. You said it's the first time you've been with us. Are you from this area, from Riverside area?
Yes, I live in Yucaipa.
Oh, okay. So if you want to join us on chat time, do you know how to get to our website?
Yes, I do. I know how to join the chat time. I got an email.
Oh, wonderful, wonderful. Okay, great. All right. Well, I think we're going to transfer over there now. Right, Adam?
Thank you.
Yeah, I did have one other comment about something I saw in the video was that offertory hymn, when they were showing all the different pictures of all the different events, there were a number of all of us or none pictures. I don't know if folks saw that. There were a number of pictures of all of us none movements. And there was a friend of mine was in one of them. Megan is, she's part of the chapter in Spokane, Washington. But the, her picture was like really big up on one of the screens. And I kind of yelled out in my room, "Hey, that's Megan." So I think I'm going to share it to Facebook and tag her. Great.
Yeah.
But yeah, no, we, chat time. Yeah. If you got an email this morning, there's a link right there for chat time. If not, it's on the church website. So see y'all there.
See y'all there.
Thank you.